Welcome to Nerd Alert, everyone. I am joined by a very special guest today. I got a lot of great things out of WonderCon, and one of them was meeting someone cool, and his name is Alan Sizzler Kistler. Boom.
Hello.
Hello. So Alan has a very cool job, an enviable job. He is a geek consultant, but he's also a writer.
So I try.
Tell us about your pedigree, if you will.
I mean, basically, I've been working on different websites for a number of years now, talking about geeky topics and being a geeky journalist. But I've become known as a comic book historian and a geek consultant because
You're an author?
Yeah, and I've done the unofficial Game of Thrones cookbook.
What?
And Doctor Who a history.
What is your favorite recipe from the unofficial Game of Thrones cookbook?
Tyrion's leg of lamb is just awesome.
No lemon cakes?
The lemon cakes are, no. The problem is I don't have much of a sweet tooth. So everyone's like, I love the lemon cakes. Like, that's good. That's for you.
All right.
The meat, that's for me.
Is it weird meat or is it meat that people can find readily?
I was approached about this project by the author, I mean, not by the author, by the publisher, and basically they wanted a user-friendly book that just people wouldn't have to, you know, make special trips to some far-off country where only this meat was available. Now, if you just want to have a Game of Thrones party or just make breakfast or just make some fun mixed drinks, here you go.
I like the Ramsay Snow sausages.
Oh, no. No, stop that.
What? He was talking about eating sausage.
Yeah, of course he was. So, you also wrote for, you wrote Agents of S.T.Y.L.E.
Yeah.
You write on the Mary Sue very regularly, and what was your book about Doctor Who? You're somewhat of a great expert on Doctor Who.
Which is way fun to have yourself known as an expert on. It's basically a history not just of the show, because I'd seen a lot of books that were about the show, but I wanted to talk about behind the scenes, as well as how stories evolved, the ideas that weren't used, the ideas that were abandoned, and also how everything in the related media tied into it and influenced it, whether it was the comics or the Dalek stage plays or the audio dramas from Big Finish that continue to this day and are fantastic. It's one of those properties where in America with Star Trek, we kind of have, there's the movies and the TV show, and then everything else is tangential and kind of cool, but it can be seen as just this other thing. And with Doctor Who fandom in the UK, it's all related and it all feeds on each other. And I just thought that was really interesting, so why not talk about all of it?
Do you not get the complete experience if you miss on one medium?
I think you'd absolutely get a complete experience whichever path you choose.
Oh.
I think it's a kind of a wonderful thing of that, where if you just follow the audio plays, if you're just listening to new Fourth Doctor adventures with Tom Baker, it's really fun and you can totally enjoy that. Now, if you're also listening to the other audio plays or watching the show, you might pick up on little connections they're making, a little reference they make to this person, like, oh, and that's going to show up later, or, well, he's talking about that time he did that. That's always fun, but it's not necessary. And I think it's really interesting that you have a franchise that does that.
So on a scale of, let's compare it to Lord of the Rings, which one is more in-depth in terms of a back universe and lexicon and...
Well, I would say Lord of the Rings is probably more in-depth because he basically wrote the Bible when he made the Silmarillion.
Yeah.
And Doctor Who, although there's a lot of world building, not all of it is necessary. You'll have alien races you just see for an episode, and then they're gone. And the Time Lords, part of Doctor Who and his people, the Time Lords, is you want to keep a lot of that mysterious. It's meant to be Doctor Who. Even if you ever did learn his name, there has to be mystery behind the character.
Right.
And you don't want all the answers of, you know,
so
is he the seventh son?
That's part of why. That's a smart answer.
Yeah.
So I'm a little bit intimidated about getting into Doctor Who because it seems so extensive. As a newbie, where should I start?
I always tell new people, just if you want to start and you just want an easy experience, so to speak, the new show was at least originally written to bring in a new audience and to be a continuation of the old show but still a new era. So just season one, episode one, Rose. And you can find that on Netflix. And I usually, for some friends of mine who are also curious about the old show, I usually tell them, watch the first three episodes. I tell everyone, watch the first three episodes of season one. Because that also gives you a good idea of the fact that this show has no genre. and you can see different areas that it explores, because the TARDIS can go anywhere. So if you want a horror story, he'll wind up on a planet ruled by vampires. And if you want a mystery, he'll be in 19th century London. And if you want space opera, it's the 853rd century, and there's an intergalactic civil war going on, whatever. So I think the first three episodes give you a nice flavor of the different genres, and if you dig it, enough to continue.
Okay, so I'll try that first, and it sounds a little bit less intimidating. I didn't say not intimidating, I said less. So real quick, you write for the Mary Sue, and this is known as the Guide to Girls and Geek Culture, or Girls Geek Culture, rather. What is one topic that you would say is at the forefront of your mind or very important to you?
Representation. I speak a lot about the need for better representation, whether it's women, whether it's different ethnicities, whether it's LGBTQ. And I even get more annoyed when some people say, but you're not gay and you're not a woman.
You don't have to be.
Exactly. You don't have to be. And it's just annoying to me. We're not farther than we are. Mm-hmm. We should be so much farther than this. We should not still be arguing or seeing people argue online about, well, can this guy be black because he's not black in the comics or something.
Are you talking about Johnny Storm?
I am talking about Johnny Storm. I got into a big Twitter. He would call it a debate. I would call it a smackdown.
massacre, battle, whatever.
Just he was talking about, well, if you change that, it's like saying Superman didn't come from Krypton. No, dark color doesn't need an origin story.
Okay.
It doesn't. You know, it just, there are characters where if you change something about them, you need to take into account what you're changing. If you're saying the Black Panther is now Canadian, that changes his story. He's supposed to be king of an African nation.
Why do people get so angry and vehement and hostile even about changes like this that may not seem like a life-changing, horrible disaster that they paint it to be?
I think, and I can relate to this, especially with geeks. I mean, part of being a geek is you have a passion.
Mm-hmm.
And you have a passion for this fictional...
That's a big part of it.
Yeah, and you have a passion for this fictional thing that spoke to you for whatever reason, and that you enjoy, and that you can either escape to, or that inspires you and whatnot. And when someone wants to change an aspect of it, you can get defensive. But mm-hmm. I think we also have to keep into account most of what, especially our generation, likes has been changed. You know, Batman, if you're just like, oh, I'm the ultimate Batman fan, but you probably met the version of Batman that's been around for the past 20 years, as opposed to the 1939 version, which was different from the 1940 version, which is very different from 1964.
Mm-hmm.
All of these things evolve. It's not like certain period piece characters like Sherlock Holmes, where he kind of sticks usually in this one place and time. Even then, you can get a modernization. So we just have to be open to, you know, these characters, one, they're always changing, whether we acknowledge that or not, and two, they're not just for us. We want to expand it for the next generation, and if kids can see Falcon and a Black Johnny Storm and just see them as superheroes and not, well, they're here because we needed black people, that's good.
Alan, that's very insightful. I can see how you got the job as as geek consultant. All right, well, we'll have Alan around all week for all of our stories, a lot of them related to some of the things he just said, so I'm really excited for that. Please stick around, and Alan, thanks for joining us.
Absolutely.